There we go. Hello, hello. Good afternoon. How are you guys doing? Thank you so very much for joining us. My name is Freddie Machate and I am your host this afternoon. Welcome to yet another SciFest Africa webinar. And if you've been joining us, you would know that we've been at this since October. And to be honest with you, it has been exciting. If you have lost or missed out on some of the webinars that we've hosted, please do visit our website where you'll be able to see this. Today we have an interesting topic and I'm so excited because we have young scientists in the house and it's really exciting. Let's have a conversation, and the conversation today is going to be focusing on climate change and our oceans, impact and solutions. I think the topic says it all, and to help us go through this session is going to be, you know, WWF South African Sustainable Seafood Initiative, SASSI. And they will be engaging in meaningful cutting edge conversations around climate change and its impact on the marine ecosystem. They're going to be using findings from the latest international research coupled with local indigenous knowledge, providing a lens into the topic of climate change and oceans. And really, I think that we have a lot to learn. We have had other sessions where we focused on oceans and indigenous knowledge, and we focused on at a certain point on the ocean and the blue economy and building a sustainable economy around that. And today, really, we're going to be delving more deeper into this topic of climate change. Two very special ladies to help us go through this topic. The first one is called Katanya. She is a conservation project officer for WWF-SA. Her science communication work is also being applied to WWF-SA's circular plastic program and WWF's conservation champion program. She holds a master's in biological science from UCT. She serves on the board of Southern African Faith Communities Environment Institute and is a Credence Institute associate. Katanya was profiled as one of Mzansi's top 100 young leaders in 2017 and in 2020 represented South Africa at the Club of Rome Youth Summit. Wow, Katanya. Delcy, on the other hand, she will be helping Katanya, and she is also a conservation project officer for WWSA in the Marine Program. She has a master's degree in ichthyology from Rhodes University. She worked as a part-time lecturer in the extended studies unit at Rhodes University. Her work at WWF-SASSI cuts across different work streams and involves research and science communication. Delcy is also an active member of the Golden Key. She was awarded the Investec Top 100 Leaders Award at Rhodes University in 2018. Wow, wow, wow. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me with a warm virtual welcome, Delcy and Katanya, onto the platform. Delcy, thank you. Katanya, thank you. The floor is really all yours. Please do feel free. This is home. And for those of you that are watching, please also communicate with us. If you're watching from Zoom, please do use the Q&A function. And of course, if you're watching us from Facebook, please use the comment section. We will be monitoring those. Over to you, Delcy and Katanya.
Thank you so much, Freddie, for that lovely introduction. And we also appreciate the introduction. And also, we'd just like to thank the audience for taking the time, you know, to come join us on a Friday afternoon as we discuss climate change and our oceans. Just going to quickly put my slide on full view, and then we can start. Okay, I'm just waiting for my screen to go in full view. Currently. Okay, that's perfect. So before we start and we dwell into our impacts, our climate change and oceans. Firstly, we can start off by doing a little bit of exercise and a little bit of engagement in the chat function. So basically you have picture A and picture B in front of your screen. When you look at those pictures, you know, what comes to mind? And also, do you think we're currently experiencing picture A, picture B, or both? And please feel free to post your answers on the chat function. And hopefully, when we are done with the presentation, you can see where we currently are in the world, and also to see if you have changed your opinion or have not. Let's get into it. South Africa is ranked third in the world for marine species found nowhere else on Earth. It is reported to have the third highest marine endemism, with an estimated of 33% of its marine fauna only found in South Africa. Valuing our ocean is one of the most important, as they provide countless ecosystem services, ones that you might not immediately think about. And I know some of you are not close to the coast and are probably thinking, but I don't see the ocean, you know, I don't go out to swim in the ocean, or I don't eat seafood. But we don't realize that the ocean provides us with so much more than just what we see with our eyes. But it provides us with ecological, cultural, spiritual, and recreational value. Hence, it's always important to value our oceans. Now think about the air that you breathe. The oxygen is responsible for producing the world's oxygen. So now when you wake up and you breathe first thing in the morning, you should think of the ocean. And when you take, when you release carbon dioxide, just know that the ocean is responsible for absorbing a third of the air that we breathe out. And the ocean further regulates our climate and form clouds that bring in fresh water. So every time you take a glass of water, think of the ocean. I know that some of us who have studied science or are interested in science or like watching National Geographic, the first thing that comes to mind when we think of the ocean is we think of kelp, we think of fish, we think of seaweed. We also think of some of the many majestic species that you could find in the ocean. But for other people, they normally think of the food that they will either have for lunch or supper. You know, thinking about buy one, get one for sushi on Fridays. And besides seafood, the oceans are connected to what you eat in many more ways. For instance, ocean ingredients such as algae and kelp are used in making peanut butter, pear, soy milk, frozen food. Plus, it is also important to note that 36% of the world's total fisheries catch yearly is ground up into fish meal and oil that is used to feed farmed fish, chicken, pigs that will end up on your plate. Also, think about your bathroom cabinet. Who would have thought that ocean ingredients will be there? And you'll find ocean ingredients flowing out of your medicine cabinet in everything from the shampoo that you use in the morning, and also cosmetics to medicine that helps fight cancer, heart condition, and viruses, and also other diseases as well. We cannot forget about the jobs and our economy, as those are very important. In South Africa, the fishing industry contributes to 0.5% of our GDP, and commercial sectors employs around 50,000 people on a seasonal and permanent basis, and a lot more when we include independent and also include tourism. The ocean is indeed a shared resource, and many of us enjoy the spectacular of it by doing recreational activities that the ocean offers. For some people, the oceans are a lifeline for survival. Keeping our oceans healthy keeps people healthy. We each have a personal responsibility to ensure that we value our oceans on a daily basis. I would now like to hand over to my colleague, Tanya, who will be talking about the threats to our oceans, including climate change, and some insights into the WWF report that modeled climate scenarios and explored indigenous knowledge on how climate change is impacting our oceans. Tanya, I'd like to hand over to you.
Thank you, Dalsy. So our oceans are just as valuable as the species that depend on them. And our oceans have absorbed 28% of the carbon dioxide emitted through human activities and more than 90% of added heat since the 19th century. This system is critical to our survival, but there are many threats that our ocean faces. And five of these major threats to our ocean are overfishing, pollution, habitat destruction, invasive species, and climate change. And today we'll be focusing more on climate change and a little bit on overfishing. With a growing population, there has been an increased demand for seafood. In a WWF boat to plate report, it was recorded that the total seafood consumption in South Africa in 2010 was 312 million kilograms per year. In per capita terms, global fish consumption rose to from 9 kilograms of weight in 1961 to 20.5 kilograms in 2018. This means that our parents were eating 9 kilograms of seafood a year, and we are now eating more than double that. 94.2% of the world's fish stocks are currently fully fished or considered unsustainable. And with this exponential growth in population, we are experiencing a case of growing appetites and shrinking seas. Imagine a world where we have healthy ecosystems and resilient ecosystems that are better equipped to adapt to change. But first, cue climate change. In order to create this world that's resilient, we need to understand the problem. Climate impacts on our oceans paint a grim picture, showing up as sea level rise, having implications for low-lying islands, coasts, and communities, changing marine ecosystems and species distributions, ocean acidification causing coral bleaching and other effects, the effects on dependent communities, and extremes in weather and other abrupt changes. Now, South Africa's unique approximately 3,000 kilometer coastline is a mix of different systems and currents that underpin our ecosystems, which means that there'll be a varied response to climate change and other effects. A general observation is that the cool west coast is getting cooler and the warm east coast is getting warmer. The west coast of South Africa is surrounded by the cold Benguela current and upwelling. And sections of the south and west coast are seen to be cooling seasonally. And although few species can tolerate cold water, and known as temperate species, they're found here in large numbers and form the basis for South Africa's fisheries, such as snook, sardine, and kingklip. These regions may contract, with coastal species being cold water tolerant, affected by possible upwelling, extremes in temperature, and habitat loss, ultimately leading to a decrease in diversity and abundance and having huge implications for the fishing industry and fisher livelihoods. Now, the east coast of South Africa has the Agulhas current bringing in warmer water from the tropics, which is not as rich in nutrients, but it is rich in biodiversity. The climate here is subtropical and the fish are dominated by warm water or tropical species. And a greater variety of species is found along this coastline, making it the most diverse. This region also accounts for a large proportion of our coastal richness and biodiversity, as well as small-scale fishing communities' food and livelihoods. The surface waters along the east coast are warming, and this has been linked to warming and strengthening of the warm Agulhas current. And tropical species may move southward in response to warming temperatures, causing an expansion of the subtropical region. Our third ocean is the Southern Ocean. This ocean is one of the richest in nutrients, zoo and phytoplankton. And this environment serves as the feeding and breeding grounds for many marine species, including large mammals like the humpback whale. It is also the largest carbon sink of the world, and this means that it removes a significant amount of carbon from the atmosphere. Any disruption in this ocean, like warming or increased freshwater inflow from melting of the Antarctic ice, will disrupt this system. South Africa actually shows the highest regional variability in oxygen, acidity, and temperature globally. And this means that South Africa's dissolved oxygen is decreasing, whilst ocean acidity and sea temperatures are increasing. Ocean acidification is also likely, where there's too much of carbon dioxide input into the ocean, which changes the chemistry, making it more acid. Now, why is this a problem, you may ask? Imagine losing your home, possible mates, food choices, and many other important faculties. This is not very far from what's happening to many of our marine species. They're moving out of their normal habitat ranges to favorable areas as the water temperature changes. Experiments also show that warmer, more acidic water is disrupting fish ability to find food, to find a home, and is preventing beneficial relationships with other creatures. As the ocean acidifies and dissolved oxygen decreases, the physiology and ecology of marine species are also expected to be affected. Changes in oxygen can affect survival, reproduction, and growth, as well as resistance to disease. The acidification affects growth, larval mortality, and even behavior in certain groups of marine organisms. This affects especially the calcifiers, or for example, shellfish, in their natural environment, as acidification alters the calcium carbonate skeleton in their shells. And changes in species distribution can affect the combination of predators, parasites, and competitors in an ecosystem, causing changes to the entire ecosystem function and productivity. When climate changes, pretty much everything can change. Now, when it comes to fish in particular, they are more susceptible to changes in temperature than many of our land-based animals. Because their body temperature is similar to the water around them, fish struggle to maintain a constant body temperature and struggle to survive in temperatures too far out of their normal range. Of all of the stresses associated with climate change, temperature is considered to have the most impact on coastal fish. And fish need large amounts of oxygen to fuel their high metabolisms and as well as for their reproduction and growth. South Africa's important marine fisheries also depend on coastal and offshore ecosystems, with the main commercial stocks being sardine, anchovy, Cape hake, horse mackerel, rock lobsters, tuna, sharks, squid, and prawns. Anchovy and sardine are fished the most by volume, and adult stocks depend on this upwelling on the west coast region, while the south coast is important for their spawning. Hake, abalone, rock lobsters, and squid are among our most valuable resources. And a study on the vulnerability of South African fisheries to climate change actually identified the lionfish and small pelagic fisheries as the most vulnerable in the face of climate change. West Coast rock lobster, squid, and the marine aquaculture sectors were identified as having medium vulnerability. rising sea levels have been recorded all along South Africa's coastline, and increased coral bleaching on the northeast coast has affected reef health. Overfishing may result in reduced genetic variability of fish, which might negatively affect their evolutionary response to climate change, as well as the ability of depleted stocks to recover. That is quite scary. Stocks under already intense exploitation pressure are likely to become more vulnerable to the effects of climate change. And this is not an ideal scenario for our oceans and for all of us who depend on it. Changes in the ocean have impacted marine ecosystems, as we've seen, and the negative impacts of climate change are also expected for food security, local cultures, and livelihoods. These impacts on ecosystem services already have negative consequences for the health and well-being of Indigenous people and local communities who are dependent on fisheries. WWF South Africa was part of an extensive international research project, which culminated in a 2020 publication. It's called Small-Scale Fisheries in a Warming Ocean, Exploring Adaptation to Climate Change. This study actually reveals alarming insights from some of our popular fisheries in South Africa. Workshops were held with fishers and other stakeholders in three countries, including South Africa, and aimed to discover local indigenous insights as a valuable source of information in order to assist sustainability in the sector. Fishers were asked to list changes that they observed during the last 10 years, and they listed a lot of changes, which were grouped into three main categories. Climatic conditions being the first, impacts on ecology and biology of marine resources, and thirdly, fishing practices. Changes in climatic conditions already observed locally by stakeholders and attributed to climate change in the last 10 years were increased seawater temperature and strength of winds. It appears that climate change is already a tangible reality for most, seen in the effects on marine resources and fishing activities. Among the changes observed by fishers and other stakeholders were that in ecology and biology of marine resources. And some of these sorts of changes include decrease in fish availability, either due to the decrease in fish abundance or the change in fish distribution, changes in trophic relationships, either regarding fish predators or seabirds. Fishers remembered seeing fewer seabirds as well, and changes in seasonality and species life cycle, inducing disturbances in fishing practices. Some species were also found in different places at the same time of the year, pushing fishers to travel further to catch these fish. And this is already happening with snook along our coast. Changes in fishing activities and practices have also been observed locally by stakeholders, as increase in distance to shore for fishing, reduced fishing yields, reduced areas to fish, reduced number of suitable fishing days, and an increase in the number of fishes. South African fishers listed a lot of already significant changes in their activity because of climate change. And this is a clear sign that climate change doesn't just pose a threat to our marine species, but to fishers and those who depend on our oceans the most. Climate effects on South African species in the line fishery were also explored in the study. And these were identified as being the most vulnerable fisheries towards climate change. The report assessed species vulnerability to change, in terms of their relative temperature, sensitivity, their adaptive capacity, and the potential regional extent of such changes, along with the individual species' degree of exposure to climate change. Some of the species that were modeled around climate change scenarios are snook, carpenter, and keelback. One of the major lionfish species is the sassy green listed favorite, snook. Snook appears on the edge of its temperature range and will probably be severely impacted by sea warming, even if actions are taken to prevent this. Snook was found to have a medium risk of climate impact. Carpenter sea bream also appears on the edge of its temperature range and will probably be severely impacted by sea warming, even in the case of a strong mitigation scenario. Carpenter is green listed for the lion fishery, yet it's one of the most threatened species in terms of biomass. This species has a medium risk of climate impact and is highly vulnerable to climate change. Carpenter has a particularly high risk of impact linked to temperature change. Lastly, keelback, also known as Cape salmon, is classified as highly vulnerable. But it is in fact a species already living in hot temperatures, and thus it will probably suffer less from predicted sea warming, even in the worst climate change scenario. Keelback is on the SASSI red list and is considered to be a collapsed species. Keelback has a high vulnerability and a high risk of impact linked to climate change. It is also one of the most threatened species in terms of biomass. Now that I've painted a very depressing picture, you might wonder if all hope is lost. Well, these findings add an additional area for concern for our valuable fish species. There is hope in fisheries that are successfully managed to achieve sustainability of our resources. Our oceans are likely to be more robust to the effects of climate change if the compounding stresses from overfishing, habitat degradation, pollution, and other anthropogenic factors are reduced. I'll now hand over to Dalzy, who will shed some light on these solutions and look forward to a more promising future.
Thanks, Kitanya, for that. I mean, you have painted a real problem that we are currently facing around the world. And I'm guessing our audiences are now thinking, is it all lost? You know, what can we do? Whether as individual, organization, and also the government. And to answer the question, it is all not lost. And I think Kitanya has said it well, that there is still hope and we can make a difference. In terms of fisheries management, it is important that management considers two views, which includes the science view and also the small scale fisheries view. Firstly, the science view. Fisheries that are successfully managed using science to achieve resource sustainability will be better positioned in the long term to adapt to climate change. Secondly, I think the WWF report study that my colleague talked about showed that indigenous knowledge is very important that we get from small-scale fishers, as they are the ones that are fishing on a daily basis. So they know some of the changes that are happening. And if we put these two together, it would be great for co-management. And these are key to ensuring we manage our resources successfully. We also need to continue exploring alternative ways to meet our management goals, especially now in a changing world. And this should include adaptive management action, such as effective monitoring, control, and surveillance of our ocean, setting precautionary targets or total allowable catch that can change as our ocean resources are changing, and also using an ecosystem-based approach, and also develop more research on fisheries adaptation with the changing environment. We also need to further decrease our greenhouse gas emission. And in the ocean, this can be done by reducing fishing vessel gear and replacing towed fishing gears with a lot of fuel with passive gears, and also increasing fuel and vessel efficiency. But however, it is very important to note that in doing so, we should be careful as to ensure that the fishing effort remains within sustainable limits. And everyone can help in the fight to save our ocean. And this is where it is important as individual to use your buying power and choose sustainable. The most important thing that consumers can do for the ocean is to buy sustainable fish. Sustainably managed fish stocks will cope better with the changing environment. As healthy stocks, sustainable fisheries governance means fishing has a reduced footprint on the ecosystem. This leads to a more resilient ocean population and also our habitat as well. Healthy stocks also means less fuel and other resources needed in order for us to harvest those resources. But I mean, the question now is, how do you know that your seafood is sustainable? This is why to be at SASSI do, so that we ensure that for consumers, it's easy to know which seafood is sustainable. So what is SASSI? SASSI, also known as the Southern African Sustainable Seafood Initiative, is a quick traffic light reference guide to assist our consumers in environmentally responsible seafood choice. What it aims to do is that it aims to create awareness that will lead to action, and also creates guides our consumers towards more environmentally friendly choices, and also discourages consumers from choosing illegal and unsustainable seafood without even knowing, and to also shift consumers' demand away from exploited species to more sustainable species. On to the SASSI list. So we are using the green, orange, and red. So basically, if you see a seafood or species on the green list, it means that it's the best choice, you can buy it, and it's more sustainable, and the population is managed well. If you see a species on the orange list, know that there are some concern around that species, but also it can still be sold. So if you want to have it, think twice. And our seafood on the red list, overfished species, and some of them will be prohibited or no sell. And we advise our consumers to not buy this fish. And the SASSI listing process that says which seafood category species is has become more robust and scientific, and has been updated and keeps on being updated every few years as new information is given. SASSI listing has evolved and now uses the Commonwealth Capture Methodology, which is an international best practice. For the first time, there's a transparent process in place that identifies where a species of fishery is progressing well and it lies. It also clearly outlines how a species assessment has. So basically, each species assessment has three categories. The first category is species specific. So this looks at the population of that species that we're assessing to see if it is either the population has decreased or it has increased or it has remained stable over the years. The second part looks at the ecosystem impact. Is the method that is used to fish that species, is it likely to harm the environment? Is it likely to also harm endangered and threatened species? And the last category that we look at is the management. Do we have management in place that will ensure that that species does not become extinct in the future? And depending on how this, the species scores within each of the category, and the overall score will determine which color your seafood will be in. So in order for you to know if your seafood is sustainable, there are three most important questions that would like consumers or anyone who wants to know about sustainable seafood. The first question is, what is it? What species is it? And this is important as local research has shown that in restaurant, the 80% of the fish that's bought is mislabeled, meaning that you think you're eating one fish, in actual sense, you're eating another. The second question that you have to ask is, where does it come from? And this is important as it will determine whether that seafood is sustainable or not. The last question to ask is, how was it caught or farmed, as the different methods will likely have an impact on the environment. For instance, coral and line will probably score better because it doesn't affect the environment when you compare it to trawl and other species. Therefore, it is important to ask the three questions in order to make the choice of seafood sustainable. And we have the SASSI tools that will help you in making those right choices. And these are also updated as soon as our listing also changes. We have the pocket card and the poster, and we also have our free app, which you can download and can stay on your phone. We also have our website. We have our fish SMS, where you can just send a message and an automatic reply will come. And please do follow us on our social media, where we also update on oceans and sustainable seafood on both Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. We will put this up in the chat as links for you to follow up. And besides sustainable seafood, there are other few actions that you can take in ensuring that you're keeping your oceans in mind and reduce climate change. There's a lifestyle behavior changes such as, firstly, know where your food, clothes, and belongings come from and what it took for them to get to you. And also green your commute. And if we were not in the pandemic, I'd say, you know, car share with someone or use the public transport. But in this case, you know, instead of going to somewhere for a meeting, you can have a virtual meeting as well. And be plastic smart. Also refuse problem plastics. These are plastics made from fossil fuels, and reduce plastic consumption where possible. Also consume less and waste less, and all products require energy materials to be built and packaged, transported, and they also need to be sold. So if you buy less, it's what you need at that time. And also reduce your meat consumption, as meat is known to, meat production is known to contribute to our carbon footprint. For instance, have a meat-free Monday, or once a week have a plant-based meal. Also, help reduce greenhouse gas emission from transport by using local ingredient. So for instance, instead of buying an ingredient that has that's coming from another place, see if locally that product is available and use it. Also, use energy wisely. Invest in energy efficient appliances as well, because that will help in reducing your energy. Diverse from forward fuels. This can be done in a corporate level, faith institution, and through personal investment. And in doing so, you will ensure that you are contributing to actions that will reduce climate change. And with the reality of the unsustainable use of our natural resources, illegal wildlife trade, poaching, some of the diseases that we currently have, there has been no any other choice but to place climate change and nature conservation higher up on our priority list. We are all beneficiaries, as I said previously, to our oceans. Therefore, we need to ensure that we protect it. We can achieve achieve this if you all come together and start making small changes. Imagine if I make a small change and someone else make a small change, then we come together. And it's also, we hope that when reflecting back on those two pictures that I shared early, that you are looking towards and acting to ensure, you know, we have picture B in the future as well. A brighter and more hopeful future for all of us and also the future generation. And thank you.
Wow, thank you, Delcy and Tanya, for such a beautiful presentation. I think even the people that are here with us on the platform send the same sentiments. I'm just going to take two comments. Melissa, watching from Facebook, she says, way to go, WWF-SASSI team. And Aishan also saying, also around the same sentiment, saying, enjoying this press, well done to the SASSI team. Thank you so much for such insights. And I think it places us or gets us to a place where, you know, we reflect on our actions and how we are also playing a part in this whole picture that you paint. And as you said, I think the small actions, small changes that each individual does has potential to change our situation. If you are watching, please do use the Q&A's function on Zoom to send any questions or comments. And if you're watching from Facebook, do use the comment section to post your questions. We will be monitoring that. We do want to engage with you. But I think just to kickstart our conversation, I would just like to know, I mean, I know that we're not going to spend a lot of time on the climate change aspect because I know that's not your specialty, but I would like to know, I think as a starting point, what is the WWF doing in an effort to address climate change? And either one of you can take it, either Tanya or Delcy.
I'm happy to answer that as far as I can. Delcy can speak a little bit more about what we're doing on the SASSI side, but I think as WWF South Africa, there's a range of work being done in the space. Obviously, contextualizing climate change within the international crisis and international solutions, as well as adapting that to a very local context as well. So one of the things that I'm quite proud of that WWF's doing is promoting that transition to renewable energy by 2050 and supporting these kinds of actions and initiatives, driving innovation and transformation towards low carbon economies. You know, whether it's city design or transport or production, there's a whole range of places where WWF is involved in that conversation and in that change. And just supporting initiatives, whether they're projects or, you know, municipalities or national policies, dialogue involving multilateral agreements and governments, including corporates. So bringing corporates into the space as well, whether it's helping them to meet science-based targets and involving them in the conversation and the action as well. And then, of course, I think climate financing is one of the big things as well, and working towards that divestment of fossil fuels and so on. So there's a lot happening on many levels within WWF and climate change. I'll hand over to Delcy to tell you a bit more about the SASSI work in climate change.
Okay, thank you so much, Kitanya, for that. And I think before I even get into SASSI, because we are part of the marine team, I mean, the marine team is also looking at alternative livelihoods because they realize that there will be and there are impacts to our ocean, which will affect those communities that depend on seafood, you know, as their everyday livelihoods. So we're also involved in that. And in terms of the SASSI work that we do, we have also realized that And this is something that's still in discussion that, you know, maybe as part of the assessments that we do, it will be interesting. And I think it'd be important for us in the future to start seeing, you know, how climate change will have an impact in terms of the species that we do profile and that we do assess on our website.
Yeah, interesting. And we speak about these, you know, communities that depend on seafood. But another issue I think that we would directly look at is job loss if this is going to, you know, continue increasing, if climate change is going to continue increasing. What are some of, you know, the insights that we have on that, and how are the communities that you work with responding to the potential of job losses, which is a reality? I mean, I think in South Africa, we are saying that we need jobs, but we also have this big threat to, you know, to the job system. I would like to really know what are some of those communities that you work with, how are they responding to this reality?
Okay, thank you for that. I'm happy to start, and then Kitanya, you can just jump in anytime. And I've been lucky because I was involved in going to a few coastal workshops that were part of a project that looked at, you know, how are communities responding to the changes, and, you know, what are they seeing in their waters? And I think the reality is that they do see, you know, what the changes are. And I think it's community basis, it's community to community. And I think what's nice is that they are willing to engage, you know, with the science, with government to say, if they are on the alternatives, yes, we'll take it. But, you know, it's community to community. That's why, you know, when you are with communities, you have to go ask them, you know, what do they want to do at the end of the day? But I think most of the communities that I've been involved with, that I've seen, are willing to say, okay, you know what? Since we're not finding fish, you know, is there an option for us to maybe get other permits that will allow us to go even further to fish, or to say, you know what, okay, maybe we cannot fish. What else can we do to ensure that there's income and food on our plate?
Yeah, just to add to that, I think I'm not personally going to assume how communities perceive this, and I don't think WWF is in any position to assume that perspective. But from what I can say, the work that has been done in the small scale fishing communities and even the small scale farming communities around regenerative agriculture and so on, and climate resilient ways of farming, whether it's on our small scale farms or whether it's on our large scale wine farms, there is that knowledge that there is a need to adapt and to do things differently so that their work and their livelihoods can continue on into the future. So we are finding that a lot of our fishing communities are also refusing to catch the red listed species and go for a lot more of the green listed species, knowing that they need to give these species a chance to recover so that they can have it for the future. So I think there is that understanding and that collaboration happening in the space as we start to speak to each other and to exchange views to come to that kind of solution. And then I think just from a WWF perspective, which I think we're safer to speak on, is that we are definitely looking at things like just transitions, whether that's in our marine protected areas or whether it's in switching to renewables or alternative livelihoods. Just transition is so important because in our work, we can't really say that we can achieve environmental justice without bringing along that social justice with it. And it's something WWF is constantly working on, especially in this really unique circumstance of South Africa and the history that we've experienced. I think that is definitely being considered, and the social element and people are brought so much more into the conservation space to make sure that we are changing that narrative and that we take everyone along in protecting nature, because after all, nature is here for us as well. So we need to work with that in order to ensure that we can all enjoy it for future generations.
Yeah. I think please do keep the questions coming. We are seeing the questions. We'll soon get to them. But I think it's a little bit of a follow up. It's also a related question. And when we look at the guidance that SASSI is, I mean the robot that you guys showed us, my question is to say, are we seeing behavioral change, especially from the consumer side, and how is that affecting businesses? And I'm now speaking of the people that actually go out and buy and sell, you know, seafoods and etc. And can impact be measured, especially in relation to that?
Okay. Yeah, that's such an interesting question because, you know, measuring impact is probably one of the hardest things you can do. And measuring that, like, sustainable impact is another thing. I could choose to go green today and tomorrow do the completely opposite. So it's hard for us to conclusively say that a certain critical mass is making change. But when we see it in our markets, when we see it in our restaurants, our retailers with our chefs, that buying power can be very clearly seen. So SASSI works with all of the major retailers in South Africa, and we work with a lot of chefs and restaurants in our trainings and our partnerships. And what we do see is there are influencers in those spaces. You watch MasterChef today, and you know they're plating a green listed fish. That's what you're probably going to buy tomorrow. So we're using influencers to spread that conservation message, to say you don't need to be a scientist to be an ocean champion. And in our retailers, we're seeing, well, we have retailers making time-bound commitments to the SASSI program that consumers can hold them accountable to. So they're working towards only sourcing sustainable seafood in their establishments and providing that sustainable choice for consumers already. So that is happening. And that is a program that is, I think, 16 years old and is doing really, really well. And in our consumer campaign with the West Coast rock lobster, I think in 2016, you know, restaurants responded really well to the fact that the stock of that species was at 2% of its commercial level. It was in dire straits, and restaurants took it off their menu for that season at the expense of their profit, because they knew that it meant more. And people were then, tourists and locals alike for the season, were not supporting the purchase of that species as well. So we have a lot of wins. We're seeing a lot of small shifts along the way. And we're now embarking on more of a behavior change lens of our work. And
I think we lost Tanya there. Delcy, do you want to just come?
Yes. Yeah, of course. So just to add to that, and I agree with what Tanya is saying.
Sorry.
You are back.
Okay. Sorry, we had lost you for a moment, Tanya.
You can finish up, then I'll add after. Were you done?
Okay, sorry about that. I was just saying, with our behavior change work, we're now looking at ways to bridge that action intention gap and transforming those with the awareness into action and sustained action, so that we can have even more ambassadors for change and experience larger shifts in the seafood sector. Yeah, on to you, Delvey.
Okay, thank you. I think just one more point to add is that you talked about, you know, we also, I mean, I think I've mentioned it earlier in terms of, you know, the consumer buying power, and Kitanya, something that she mentioned as well. And we've actually had chefs, you know, and restaurants who've called and say, you know what, you know, customers are asking for sustainable seafood, you know, what is a green fish? And also to just let the restaurants know that, you know, just because you're selling sustainable seafood, it doesn't mean that it doesn't make business sense. You can still make money using sustainable seafood, which we also have written a business guide for chefs and restaurants to also say sustainable seafood makes good business sense.
So, yeah.
Powerful points. I think powerful, very powerful points. And I think something to just take away from this to say everyone has a part to play, from the entertainment industry to basically everyone has a part to play, to the restaurants, etc. And actually, when you talk about buying power, I think something that is strongly coming out is the very fact that if there is no demand, then there is no need for it to be on the shelf. Then there is no need for it to be taken out of the water. Super powerful. I hope I'm saying that right, and I apologize if I'm not saying that right. Says, firstly, before I ask a question, I would like to say, well done, guys. That was very informative. I enjoyed it a lot. My question now is, is there a way people back at home can be able to contribute to conservation from this species? And I think very shortly, because I think you've already spoken about some of these things.
Yes, I mean, I can just go through them quickly. So if you're a consumer, obviously go follow the tools, make sure you have an app. And also when you go buy sustainable seafood, make sure that it's also on the green list. And also we also have a volunteer program, which Kitanya will put a link where you can be part of the SASSI when we do activations and our outreach program. So there are a lot of things that you can do within SASSI, but also within just the conservation space as a whole. You know, be a champion for the oceans. You know, always look out for, you know, programs that you can get involved in. And I mean, whether it's at home, since we're currently at home, so our voices usually are through social media. So if you have social media, you can follow us, you can chat, you can engage, and you can ask questions. So those are some of the things that you can do.
This is a question that I personally have, and I see that we are running out of time. But I hear a lot of talk about adapting. Is that the way to go? Should we be adapting, or should we be constantly looking for ways to turn the wheel back in terms of climate, the acceleration of climate change? And I think it's something that someone might be wondering to say, and I'm really playing the devil's advocate here, to say, should we be adapting, or should we be looking for real solutions to addressing this problem monster that has really attacked us, that is called climate change?
Okay. Thank you. That's actually a good question. And I think it's a question that, you know, I'm guessing some of the audiences might have had as well. I think we use the term adapting. It's because, you know, climate change was not something that just came about yesterday. So we realized that it's going to take us even longer to ensure that, you know, we reverse it back to where we are. But in order for us to get to that point, we have to adapt in the meantime until we are able to reverse it. And, you know, we no longer talk about climate change. Mm-hmm. It's just going to be longer than, you know, just
years.
Tanya? Yeah. Yeah, I think the two parts to tackling climate change is adaptation, but number one, mitigation. And I suppose a lot of people might argue it's too late to mitigate because climate change is already happening. But I think personally, there are a lot of places where we can start to mitigate the increased effects that are compounding daily. And I think mitigation is still very much part of the solution, so that we can hopefully reach a point very soon where we might have to adapt less and less, and keep that, that increase as low as possible. It is already happening. So the best time to plant a tree was yesterday. That's a quote that I really like. And, you know, the sooner we start acting, the better.
Mm-hmm. Powerful. I think this question is really inspired by the fact, I think I did say when we started off this conversation that I'm really excited because today we have younger scientists. I mean, there are a lot of seasoned scientists, and some of them are here. And just to maybe just on that note, to just quote what Prof. Mike Bruton is saying, and he's one seasoned, respected, well-renowned scientist. He says that, I think that the important point is that we are not just passengers on the spaceship Earth, but also the crew. Our action will determine the future trajectory of the planet and its biodiversity. I think it's very, very powerful. So we're not just bystanders looking at things happening. We should start to be agents of the future that we envision and start doing things that actually make a difference. But I just wanted to ask a question on research. I think you mentioned one, I think it was called the small-scale fishes in warming oceans. I think that was the research that you mentioned earlier on. My question is to say, what is the impact? Is research really informing policy, regulations, rules? And also, as young scientists yourself, do you see that you're being heard by policymakers and decision makers?
Dalzi, do you have any insights from your workshops with fishes? And then I'm happy to touch on that a bit more.
Okay, thank you. And I think just speaking, because I was involved in some of the few workshops that we held in some of the small scale fishes, is that, you have a combination of scientists and fishes as well coming together. And what we find out is that they are saying one thing. And we as a conservation agency, as WWF, work with the government, and also we engage with DEF, which they are responsible for policy. So I think to a point, I think the research that we do and the knowledge that we gain from small scale fishes goes into the government. I think some of it, I think some policy decisions that are made are because of those of that research that's being done. And I think as youth and policies, so there are a few networks for youth engagement. And I've seen a lot of youth researchers, science communication and researchers all coming together and to say, you know what, there's something that we need to do. And I think there was also one youth network that deals with policy and to say, advise policy, and they do write on our policy documents and they do hand it over to the government. So yeah, it does happen.
Thanks, Dalzi. Just in terms of the report itself, I think the first win was really just getting that indigenous knowledge from our small scale communities. So South Africa was one of the countries that were investigated in the study, and there were two other small scale fishing communities in other developing countries such as Philippines and Ecuador. And so similar findings came from those countries as well on their respective fisheries, and their fishes were also experiencing climate impacts. And so the take home from that report, I think, is generic strategies that could be identified to adapt to this new reality based on what people on the water are finding, as well as the scientific models and other stakeholders. So it was a real on the ground view of not just what science is saying from the comfort of a desk, but really incorporating that lived knowledge and, having that complement the science that we already know. And then, as Dalzi said, using that to inform and prompt policy change and effective monitoring by our governments and other stakeholders that are responsible for our resource management and livelihoods. So I think that was the huge take home. In terms of youth, Dalzi is spot on. There's a few opportunities to make our voices heard. And I think that is this intergenerational leadership is something that is really, I'm seeing a lot more, because we're at this point where we have leaders in a completely different generation to us. And we're moving into that space slowly but surely. So that succession planning as well in our sectors and in these spaces are so important, because we are in it together, and we're going to be here while the worst effects of climate change happen, and our kids as well, and so forth. So I think It's important that youth voices are heard and more opportunities are created for that. And yeah, definitely encourage youth out there to make their voices heard and to become part of organizations that have these platforms to be involved.
Powerful, powerful, powerful stuff. You guys are amazing and are inspirational. I hope that we have, you know, young girls also watching today and drawing inspiration from the amount of knowledge, the wealth in knowledge and wealth in experience at such a young age. Time is what has now been on the other side of what we're trying to do here. And I would just really like to take this opportunity to thank you guys so much. Thank you, SASSI. Thank you, WWF-SASSI. Thank you, WWF-SA. I see Pavs is also here watching. Thank you so much. We had a lot to learn. And as the comments were also coming in, they were just sharing the same sentiments. But before I just close off, do you guys have any last words that you would like to leave the platform with?
I would say the little thing that you do will make a difference.
Definitely agree with you, Dalzi. Everyone can be part of a change, big or small, on any scale. So get involved, speak to people that are being part of the change, join volunteer programs and discussion groups, make your voice heard, and don't give up hope. It gets tiring, yes, it does. And just not to give up hope and to keep making a difference, because every little action counts. Thanks so much, Freddie, and thanks to everyone for being here.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. I think the message is get involved in platforms such as Surfaced Africa, which are creating this space so that we can have these robust and important conversations. Get involved in your community, look for organizations that are movements of impact and join them and work with them. So get involved. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dalzi. Thank you, Tanya. Really, really enjoyed this session. Thank you to all the viewers. And I would like to say that the festival itself continues. Next week, we do have a session. I think it's on Tuesday with Rob Greenfield. He is an exciting character. We're going to be having an interview with him. Please register. There's a lot to learn from that guy. And on Wednesday, on the 25th, we're going to be having a conversation on energy and climate change. So also very interesting conversations that are coming up. Thank you so very much for joining us this afternoon. And from myself and the SASSI team, thank you and goodbye.